I am Dr. Arvind Sinha, Associate Professor from the School of Finance and Commerce. And today we shall be learning about what is a financial system. As we shall be discussing on the very genesis of the financial system, there are no prerequisites for this lecture. This is a class to introduce you with the financial system. After this lecture, you shall be able to define the financial system, describe various components of financial systems, elucidate entities, bodies that facilitate flow of funds and securities in a financial system, identify and describe sectors of economy that constitute non-financial lenders and borrowers. The beginning of the financial systems across the world can be understood by understanding something what is known as primitive accumulation and early capitalism. Initially, the great bulk of working population is in agriculture, and great bulk of national product is generated there. When productivity in agriculture increases and surplus is accumulated, the countryside contributes to the development of manufacturing. The countryside provides labor, wage, goods, and raw materials, and also creates home markets for manufacturing. The industry in turn provides market and new inputs to agriculture, which further increases its productivity. The transfer of surplus from agriculture to industry is described as primitive accumulation, that is, transfer of surplus from pre-capitalist mode of production to capitalist mode of production, and ultimately the transition of peasant economy itself into a capitalist agriculture. The agrarian capitalism is sometimes known as market feudalism. This was a transitional form between feudalism and capitalism, whereby market relations replaced some but not all feudal relations in a society. The theory of primitive accumulation and emergence of capitalism was given by Karl Marx and has been accepted and criticized at a multitude of global forums. The interest of this lecture is not reflecting on Karl Marx's orientation on emergence of capitalism, but to understand how financial resources of historical times organically integrated to give birth to present-day financial system prevalent throughout the globe in many countries. Now let's understand how foundation of modern-day financial system was laid on the premise of primitive accumulation and early capitalism. A very interesting way to understand evolution of present-day complex financial system is to look back at emergence of financial markets. Financial markets form very important and in fact the biggest component or the part of the financial systems around the globe. Although modern-day trading and investing is mainly computerized, many people still associate the markets with an open outcry system and the traditional hustle bustle of the New York Stock Exchange. Those days may seem like a distant past and primitive in some ways, but even those more traditional approaches were an evolution from what the market had started off. As so, what was the first stock exchange? How was it formed? And what was being traded? In this video, we are going to explore some of the history that has formed and shaped the very market we know and love today. Let us make a whistle-stop tour of the very first stock exchange. Before any real stock exchange was built, some countries had their own kind of trading systems that worked in a similar way to an exchange. In the 1100s, France had courtier d'échange, which was a group of men that managed agriculture debts on behalf of banks. They were believed to be the very first brokers since they traded these debts and regulated them all the way back 900 years ago. Most people think of Venice as a city of love, with its network of canals and astonishing cultural treasures, an ideal place for a romantic getaway. You may even think about famous Shakespeare's play Merchant of Venice, written in 16th century, you maybe won't associate it with financial markets, but in fact, some 200 or 300 years before Shakespeare's masterpiece, merchants in Vienna were trading government securities all the way back in 1300s, and they would act as a source of broker and would meet clients to provide them all the information which would be written on a slate. This paved the way for the merchants in nearby cities to start doing the same. Fast forward to another 200 years, and it's still 70 years before Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice. To put the timeline into perspective, we have the first stock exchange. This was documented to have been created in Antwerp, Belgium at around 1531. Before this, it was believed that the innkeepers controlled the securities and trades, and it was a very respected job. One of these innkeepers was Vanderbrugge's family, who ran Turbo's Inn in Bruges. Men would meet up to deal with government issues, businesses, and debts, and would meet in Turbo's Inn, or the square around it. The group was called the Bruges Brews. This is believed to be the what they began calling stock exchanges, Bourses, named after the family. There were different houses for different countries, and they would go to each house to trade commodities. There was no actual stock in these stock exchanges. Instead, they dealt in promissory notes and bonds, similar to how we trade markets today. Moving on to 1600, lots of ship owners from different countries sent ships over to East to trade or take valuable goods and bring them back to their home countries to trade. These were very dangerous trips for many reasons, including turbulent waters and pirates. This meant it was a risk to the ship owner, as they would stand to lose a huge amount of money if the ship didn't make it back. So to help decrease the risk of losing money, the ship owners would seek investors to financially back the boat and the crew for that voyage. By doing this, the ship owners was distributing some of the risk and would therefore not lose as much if the ship fell victim to one of the many dangers during the trip. If the voyage was successful, the investor would get a percentage from the proceeds. Of course, this was a risk investment for the investor. If the ship didn't return, they would lose all the money they had invested. So to reduce their own risk, they would first invest in many different ships on many different voyages, a classic case of diversification. That is, not putting all your eggs into one basket. In some cases, this would mean that even if one ship comes back, they were still make a return. They were taking a portfolio approach. A company was formed called Dutch East India Company. The Dutch East India Company became the world's first public trading company in 1602. Instead of investing in each individual ship on the different voyages, investors could buy shares in the company, meaning that they were getting a stake in a whole load of ships. Instead, this meant the company could charge more for their shares and therefore had more money for even more ships and even more voyages. The investor could also potentially earn more through dividends in the company rather than just receiving a percentage from each individual trip. Investors would receive their stocks on paper, and because of this, it meant they could either hang on to them and keep getting dividends, or they could be sold on to other investors for more money, potentially making them a profit on the asset. Many other countries began to do this with East Indian companies, including the Brits who had the British East Indian Company. In England, investors used to go to coffee shops to buy and sell these paper stocks. Since there was no physical stock exchange setup, people would have to track down the broker that they needed to and try to make a deal. If the investors around you ever had the problem of getting hold of their brokers when they need to speak them the most, imagine having to track them down in person. Investors in British East India Company started making large dividends, which then allowed them to sell their shares on to other investors for a bigger profit. There were no regulations in place for issuing and selling of the shares at this time, so more companies started to pop up and follow in their footsteps. This is when the South Seas Company was born. They managed to sell all their shares even before making their first trip. People could see that huge amount of money they had made from this and the luxury lifestyle they could afford. As a result of that, so more companies started appearing as they were. Everyone wanted to jump on the bandwagon. If this sounds similar to the things like the dot-com bubble or the recent ICO wave, that is because the famous phrase says there is nothing new under the sun. As more companies were established, a lot of these were blind shares as people didn't even really know what they were buying but decided to buy them anyway. In the end, the Southeast companies didn't make much profit and the dividends were not paid off. This caused the bubble to burst and there was a crash in England. And ultimately, the government banned the issuing of shares. The ban remained there till 1825. Once again, it looks similar to the ICO wave. So that this is the short history of how the first stock exchange came into being, that is from trading of government securities in Burmese to ban on the issue of public shares, and how the things have actually evolved in the financial system and the bases which have taken place. Let's now go on to the next slide. The picture on the slide depicts the financial system in the most generic form. People act as lenders when they have surplus money to invest and turn borrowers when they have a deficit of money. To let other people use their money for certain time, lenders charge rent on the money called interest. Borrowers pay interest to lenders. The exchange between lenders and borrowers can be direct or indirect. For indirect exchange, services of intermediaries are hired and a service charge is paid to them. Let's define the financial system. The financial system is a set of arrangements, conventions, embracing the lending and borrowing of funds by non-financial economic units and intermediation of this function by financial intermediaries in order to facilitate the transfer of funds, to create additional money when required, and to create market in debt and equity in instruments and their derivatives so that the price and the allocation of funds are determined efficiently. The definition presented on the previous slide clearly brings out six elements of the financial system. 1. The lenders and borrowers, that is the non-financial economic units that undertake lending and borrowing process. 2. The financial intermediaries, which intermediate the lending and borrowing process, meaning that they interpose themselves between the lenders and borrowers. 3. The financial instruments, that is marketable and non-marketable instruments, which are created to satisfy the needs of the various participants. 4th is the creation of money when required, that is the unique money creating ability of the banks or the capital formation by the banks. 5th is the financial markets, that is the institutional arrangement and conventions that exist for the issuing and trading of the financial instruments. And the last element of the financial system, that is the 6th one, is price discovery, that is the determination or making of the price of equity and the price of the money or debt, that is the rate of the rate of interest. To facilitate trade and to increase breadth and depth of the market, there are certain additional participants in the financial system. Let's take a look at them. The first one are the brokers and the dealers, that is the members of the stock exchanges or various commodity exchanges, and or the financial intermediaries that facilitate the trades in financial instruments, which we refer to here collectively as broker-dealer. Second are the fund managers or the portfolio managers, that is the corporate entities or departments of financial intermediaries that manage funds on behalf of principals, that is the owner or the holders of the money. And the third are the financial exchanges that allow the broker-dealers to facilitate trading in securities and to create the mechanism for clearing and settling the off trades in a risk-minimizing manner. The fourth additional participant in the financial system are the credit rating agencies, which analyze relevant financial and economic data pertaining to the issues of securities and assign ratings to the securities reflecting the probability of the issues meeting their financial obligations, that is, interest and principal repayment. The fifth and the last additional participant are the financial regulators that regulate and supervise all players in the financial systems, mainly the governments in many countries. Meaningful and efficient financial system imply high inclusion and equality. And to provide this, financial systems throughout the world have a long way to go. Let us have a look at a video from World Economic Forum on future of financial systems. According to this report, 2 billion people still do not have access to affordable, high-quality financial services. More than 200 million micro, small, and medium businesses have unmet financial needs in excess of US$2 trillion. Developing formal financial system is crucial to support inclusive economic growth and stability. Successfully servicing these customers is a global business opportunity worth at least US$300 billion per year. Financial regulations have been reworked to address systemic weakness and regain public trust. Alternative providers of capital such as crowdfunding, shadow banking, and direct P2P and B2B lenders are transforming the financial services landscape. The number of new startups attempting to capitalize on this trend is expanding. By 2014, 1,575 P2P platforms had emerged. Providing access to credit and savings to the underprivileged is critical to reduce poverty and wealth creation. To address such issues, organizations like World Economic Forum have taken initiatives for financial stability, innovation, and economic growth, international regulatory coordination, global financial inclusion, and disruptive innovation in financial services. You can find similar topics of interest on the websites of the World Economic Forum. Last but not the least, I highly recommend all of you to watch an award-winning documentary titled The Ascent of Money by Niall Ferguson. This will tell you from the beginning of the money to evolution of the modern financial system. This is a 4-hour long series. You may watch it at your convenience. The link for to access the documentary is given here. Now let's have a look at the references and credits which make this video possible. Slide 4 had a lot of text from a paper by Jaya Mehta. Paper was titled Changing Agrarian Structure in Indian Economy. Slide 5, the video credit is to Dumo Initiative Trading and Investing, which is a YouTube channel. Slide 6, the image was taken from SMB Financial Planning. Slide 7 to 11 taken references from AP Foyer Financial System and Introduction by Book Boone. And slide 12 was a video from World Economic Forum titled The Future of Global Financial System. Thank you so much.